right. We'll talk about some updates that have occurred in Market 7, Market 3, particularly around updates to the Link Data platform, particularly around editing local rules files and local Drupal store support. So, MarkEdit utilizes a couple of very specific developmental goals / rules in terms of how it's developed and worked through providing linked data support to users. A couple of those specific ones I've included here, and that's this notion: the catalogers themselves should never be copying and pasting URIs into records. The reason for that is that even though folks have are starting to have a better understanding of which URIs are actually useful in this context, there's a lot of room for mistakes. And in fact, in a number of actual examples of folks doing this work, the URIs being included actually aren't useful. In order for data to be useful in the linked data reserved URIs, these elements need to point to machine readable, machine actionable endpoints. And I think one of the things that continues to be a point of confusion is finding those endpoints, particularly since a lot of the services that we use, when they provide URIs, unless you're looking specifically for it, finding the machine readable, machine actionable URI sometimes not straightforward. So part of the goal in developing some of the workflows around the reconciliation services and link builders and whatnot is to move away from needing to have catalogers try to determine which URIs need to be selected for use inside of records. The other assumption is that, in general, I think URI resolution can be done in an automated method. It may be fairly resource intensive, and in this case is right now they are. But that large-scale resolution can be automated, and that there can actually be workflows developed to make the resolution of materials that come into the catalog day-to-day work just part of a normal workflow. The metadata is messy, so the cleaning needs to happen, and so the linked data platform makes some assumptions around the necessary patterns that would be required in order to do good resolution of particular materials. So, for example, if an item is identified as a name, there are a number of regular patterns that can be used to help optimize the process of making sure that name matches. While national and international services are important, I think that local services will be equally as important. So that means the ability to be able to support and add and profile local services will be a necessity in order to, in any tools that are built or used around any library linked data work. The reason I think that that's true is that I have a feeling that as we continue to move down this road, that groups like OCLC, who are well positioned to be able to do this kind of resolution on a very large scale database, will be able to take care of adding URIs to many of the well-known international data services. But it's going to be those local services that are either outside of the library sphere or managed locally by institutions who have specific areas of expertise that'll also be important. And one of the goals in terms of developing MarkEdit, and this is part of the reason why the rules file exists, is this idea that users will likely need to be able to profile their own content into use with the tool set. And also that in my development process and deciding between optimizing a process or making the process flexible, flexibility wins. And so there's some real-world consequences of that, particularly in terms of speed. Sometimes flexibility is slow, or can be slower, and that's a trade-off that I make in terms of developing the tools in MarkEdit. So those are kind of the assumptions that are in mind as we go forward developing this work. So right now I'm going to talk specifically about three particular tools. So MarkEdit has a linked data framework. It's a library that's available in the application. That code lives on my GitHub page, so folks can pull it down and use it for other purposes, or borrow the code to pull apart and put into other places. Internally, the application makes use of that code to create three tool sets right now. One is a Sparkle browser, one is a linked data builder, and one is a headings validator. So the Sparkle browser is a tool that really started out in MarkEdit as a way to prototype new resources that I wanted to profile into the rules file that's being utilized in the application. The tool currently in its current implementation can be used to search against either local service stores or against remote services. Excuse me. Let's see here. So this is really what it looks like. So I'm gonna bounce here back and forth a little bit. So right now, inside of MarkEdit, we have MarkText. Inside of MarkText, we have Triple Store or the Sparkle browser. So inside Sparkle browser, there are examples. Partly, the examples were provided because I found that in the last year or two, talking to a number of catalogers, I think there's a large desire to get a better understanding of how these technologies can be used, but not a lot of examples to make it easy to be able to kind of play around with them and understand them. And so what I want to do is provide some examples of how these things work in real life. So here we have an endpoint. This is the mesh endpoint, the Sparkle query that would be used to search for Flu. The outputs that you can expect. So we'll pick JSON, and we can go ahead and run the query and get back a set of results. The user can see what kind of results come back. We can see, looking at these, so this is the Getty, how the query changes based on the data models used. And so this gives a good example for the user, so that they can see the different kinds of search, and then they get their response. And finally, another national library, the Japanese Diet Library example, which shows how to embed non-Latin characters into the search, and then you can retrieve back your data set and see back the results from JSON. So we have a Sparkle browser here, which, like I said, was really designed around this notion of creating a way to profile resources. But it gives examples so the users can see how it works. Additionally, the tool provides the ability to search for local data. So one of the things that has been of interest has been trying to look at how might be able to pull down local data sets and use those for reconciliation, because obviously using the remote services can be fairly expensive. So here is the RDF data file from the Library of Congress for the children's subject heading. So it's a relatively small file, about 136 megabytes. So we'll use that as an example. So inside the tool, we can tell we want to load a local file. We can go find our search. So here's our LC authorities. And so the tool will load that local authority into an RDF memory store so that it can be queried via Sparkle. So right now, the way that this tool works, I would say that I would limit the size of the file to roughly about 1 million records. I wouldn't go much higher than a local triple store of maybe 0.5 GB. And that's partly because of the way that the memory is being managed right now locally. It's expensive. The data has to be loaded. So in this case, we loaded about half a million triples. And so we can do then a search. So I'll go ahead and pull my sample search. So here's a sample search. And so just like any of the other resources, we interact with this via Sparkle. So a local data store now has been stored as Sparkle. So in this case, we have our searches. Statement here just to make sure that everything is kosher. And then we'll go ahead and do our search and we'll tell it we want to retrieve JSON. And again, the search happens right away. The data is loaded now locally so I can interact with it and can use it in other places. So that gives us back our result. So local data, Sparkle data browsing, was added when MarkEdit originally was put out, and it was partly so that I could start thinking about how we could use those local endpoints in also resolution and ability of URIs. So I'll show you that here in a minute. So one of the tools built on top of the linked data framework is the validate headings tool. So it's kind of the first real-time tool that's been built to provide real-time validation of authority data. So this tool is integrated into the MarkEditor. It's been in MarkEdit for a while. It's kind of a proof of concept of why users may want to include or utilize linked data in their process. So in this case, this tool is designed to validate, it's a Mark 21 aware tool, validates against the 1, 6, and 7XX, and it generates a report that notes if the resources noted in the records have authority records, and if they're not, it notes those, makes it available so you can export those records for further investigation. It also provides the ability to generate brief personal records for submission to either your local catalog or name authority services, utilizing the data found inside the MARC records to help construct that initial personal brief record. And the Library of Congress has been kind enough to provide a method that allows us to actually download LC authority records on the fly as we process the data and validate the holdings, or validate the authorities. So anytime an authority record is identified as being valid, if there's an LC authority record for it, we can pull down that data. And the way that the tool does this to help minimize the impact between the resolution on id.lc.gov versus pulling down full MARC authority records really is by managing interaction between multiple services that LC runs in order to mitigate the load on any one particular system. So this process is built into the application, and I think demonstrates why some of the reasons why folks at a practical level, are excited about some of the potential of using linked data, you know, and in terms of all of the easy wins and why I would, why I think that vendors, particularly ILS providers, should be excited about supporting libraries in terms of embedding URIs into our records, really is that it simplifies authority. The initial big win is that it simplifies authority work. Right now, most of that authority work is done around, just as folks would know, done around string matching. Using those URIs, we can avoid that work. The final tool, the one that is embedded into Marketo's task services and can be integrated into your day-to-day workflow as part of a process to always embed URIs into your records, as the applications build links tool. And this is a reconciliation tool. It reconciles data against multiple formats and provides URIs for that data. There's a rules file that can be used and modified for your own local use. It's designed right now, the rules file, to support Mark 21. I have a proof of concept of this for some folks who work outside of the United States that use Unimark for folks. And eventually I hope to provide multiple rules files. So the way that this tool works is it provides a tool that allows users to automatically detect main entry, automatically detect subject IDs, and then process, in this case, the 3xx fields. There's the ability to embed VAuth records, although that functionality is functionality that's kind of it's very local and actually not what I would consider to be rules-based. There's other ways to embed VAuth data, and I'll show how that here in a minute. Using the subfield 0, subfield 1 structure that it's available in the MARC record. So let's talk about how this works. So inside of MARC Edit, we have the linked data tool. You can find it here in linked identifiers. You can find it built directly into the MARC editor. Linked data tools, build linked identifiers. You can even run it, I believe. No, just those two places. So I'm going to go ahead and pull that up really quickly. All right. So like I said, this is the rules file. This is tells MarkEdit how to interact with all the data that the users are providing. We have options to tell MarkEdit how to process the data. We have the ability to limit the resolution to a specific collection. This option for OCLC VAuth tells the tool to use VAuth to generate a subfield 0, linking to VAuth within scope to a specific index. Again, I'm not certain I would use it that way. And then this allows you to embed the OCLC work ID if one's available into your record, which is always interesting and useful. So like I said, the linked data framework provides an underlying data model that helps build tools like these three on top of MarkEdit. The driving part, though, between in the linked data framework is the MarkEdit rules file. In the rules file, because MarkEdit is utilized by a large number of international users, has been designed to work beyond Mark 21 and in RDA. It's really designed to enable users to structure their rules files to work with any data set that they might and rule set they might work with. And so, like I said, I have a Mark 21 rules file available in MarkEdit. I have a Unimark one that's available for folks who are Unimark specific that is still in kind of process. So the rules file supports two specific sections. There's a field description, which defines how tags are to be interrogated and reconciled So that the program knows which pieces of information to use while it's looking up content. And then there's the collections information that defines the rules in Sparkle queries and to basically helps Marketo understand how it should interact with the resource. And so just to look a little bit at this, there'll be slides a little bit show it, but I'm going to look a little bit at this. So in Marketo 7, one of the new pieces is there's always been a place here to edit the XML rules file. Before this looked like this, you'd receive an XML view and you would have to edit the data. So users would have to be very comfortable going into the data set here, finding a tag like the 100 field, and entering in the various XML tags that they needed to be able to support that work. MarkEdit 7, I've added an editor. So essentially, if you wanted to edit the rules tag, you click on the one you wanted to edit. Provides access to the different types of data. So in this case, the 100 field can be applied to either authority records, bibliographic records, or authority and bibliographic records. By default, it's applying just to bibliographic records. The field is the 100. The subfields used for reconciliation. Are there any indicators that determine how the tool should determine which collections in use? For the 100 field, there isn't. 100 field is in Mark 21 should always be searched against the name authority records. And so that gets defined down here. So here we have what URI is going to be used when outputting this data. So the global URI is going to be in the subfield 0. The always run, though, tells MarkEdit a little bit more about it. It overrides certain values. So in this case, what I've told the tool is that when it finds a 100 field, the data should always be checked against the LC name authority record. And that data should go into, should go into a subfield 0. But I've also told it to reconcile this data against VAuth. And if data is found in VAuth, to put that data into a subfield 1. So this way, the tool can actually stack resolution services. So for example, while the 1xx fields are supposed to be primarily entered in Mark 21 using the name authority file, LC name authority file, you may have users that are utilizing multiple authority files. And in order to capture all of those, since there's no subfield code that identifies which vocabulary you're using, you can set up in MarkEdit an option to have it resolve against multiple vocabularies looking for data in order to make sure we get that resolution correctly. There are special instructions. This tells MarkEdit, are the fields that are there personal names or names? These are one's a legacy term, one's the term that's used now. They mean the same thing. Are they subjects? Are they mixed terms? Could they be both subjects and personal names? That changes the way that MarkEdit normalizes the data. Or is it a linking field like the 880, which tells MarkEdit how to handle the data? So when we're done making changes, we click save, the data goes, gets added to the rules file again, and the data clears. There's collection rules. So collections are defined to help MarkEdit know how to interact with a resource. So let's use mesh as an example. So here we have the name of the collection, the term that shows up in the subfield 2 within the Mark record, the base URI of the service up to the point where you would see the initial arguments for the Sparkle query, and then the Sparkle query itself here that tells us how to interact with the service, and then if there's a JSON path, and for MarkEdit's purposes, JSON is what's the output expected, where you're going to find the identifier based on that resource. And when we're done, we can go ahead and save our changes there. We can also use this locally. So I profiled the children's service. There's actually a non-local entry, but for my test case here, I went ahead and profiled using the local. So that initial piece that I showed using the Sparkle browser to query a local RDF store, we've done the same thing. We've pointed to that local RDF store. We've told the application it's a local file. We've provided the Sparkle query. And then I haven't added the JSON path, but I should. But the JSON path that would be there, I would need to add that in order for that to be useful. And then I can save that. And then the tool now will be able to utilize that local RDF store rather than looking up the data elsewhere. And that allows us to do a search differently. And so that's kind of cool. That allows us to potentially resolve against local sources. So for services like the RDA registry, which I largely ignore because they don't provide a machine actionable endpoint, could actually download local RDF file, triple store file, turn it into create a local Sparkle endpoint around that content and use it for resolution purposes. And so here's the XML editor and then the headers. So what am I doing in the future? So as I've been working through Marquette 7 and working on the Mac version, one of the things that I've been experimenting with for about the last 3 months is working on the ability to support RDF HDD in Marquette. So there's a good set of C++ and Java libraries that demonstrate how to use these high compression elements for using linked data. There's the GitHub page for the Java implementation is here. This is what I've been using as my concept. So these are the Java tools. This is a particular project. It's RDF, HTTP, compressed RDF tools. I've worked with both the C++ and the Java libraries to experiment with. And the idea is that I'd like to provide a C# alternative, so a version that can be utilized in the .NET format. And there's a couple of good reasons for that. In this, without using RDF HDT, the ability to download LC's entire name authority file and use it as a local Sparkle endpoint, at least in the tools that I use, is almost impossible. The memory requirements become overwhelming. But in experimenting with these tool sets, I've been able to find that once I've compressed the LC name authority file into the HTT format, loading that data and then utilizing it for search actually becomes useful and possible. One of the things that I've been looking to do is the Java version has tools and then marries it to the Jenna project, provides Sparkle query functionality. C#, there's a component RDF.NET, which would do the same thing. So I've been working on trying to marry the functionality of being able to read search against the file that's been compressed and provide a Sparkle endpoint on top of that so that I can utilize these files in the application. I'm hoping that that'll work. Right now I have a proof of concept that works where I've taken the Java implementation and I'm using it in the C# application using a virtual machine component that essentially allows Java to run inside of a .NET environment. And it works fairly well, but there are some complications that make it difficult to use it in production work, which is part of the reason why I've been working on trying to port the code. To do that, there were a handful of steps that were required. The first one was formally enabling the local triple source support in MarkEdit, and that's been completed. I wanted to provide a tool that made editing the rules file easier because editing the XML file was a barrier, and that's been done. And so now I just need to finish developing the code for the RDF HDD formats in .NET, and that's in progress. Hoping to have this work done around March-ish, if possible, because I've been trying to, the cycles I've been using in my spare time to finish a lot of the update work will get freed. And once that work is done, I'll make it available via my GitHub page, but I'm hoping to be able to also provide it via the RDF HTTP project page if the folks there are interested in providing that hosting. Beyond MarkEdit, so one of the goals for creating the rules file the way that I have is I really would like to be able to provide this for folks to be able to have a resource for other folks who want to be able to do machine readable processing. The rules file creation is a good deal of work in terms of going through and profiling and finding and developing against all of these individual resources. And so by not hard coding that work into MarkEdit and making it available through an XML file that anybody can use, I'm hoping to encourage other folks to at least be able to make use of that work, whether they use the rules file or not. The information needed to be able to interact with those sources is available, which is kind of the goal for that project. So that's kind of where we stand right now. All of this work is available in the current version of MarkEdit 7 and available, almost completely available in the MarkEdit Mac version, the last part of the component in MarkEdit Mac that needs to be integrated is the XML editor for the linked data rules file. That's one of the two components that haven't been finished in the porting process to create parity between MarkEdit 7 and the MarkEdit Mac 3 version. And that work should complete sometime over the next couple of weeks. So that's kind of where we're at. And if you have questions about the process, let me know.